right. Well, good morning to you, church. Hate to be the guy to stop the conversation. It's good to see you connecting, fellowshipping before. That's effective. That's effective. Well, good morning. My name is Clay Munzer. I'm the associate pastor here. I'm grateful that you joined us today for service. Just a few things I want to put before you. It's an exciting day. We get to hear from Petrucia's today about Chi Alpha Ministry in just a moment. But a few things going on. I'll push you to our bulletin this morning. A lot on there. I'll just highlight a few things. Number one, our rummage sale is coming quickly on July 23rd. That's going to be hosted at the Roloff's house. If you would like to donate to that, you can do that. If you'd like to serve that day at the rummage sale, we're in need of that as well. You can sign up, learn more about that at the Welcome Center. All proceeds for that rummage sale are going to go to the Building to Serve campaign. A lot of other stuff going on. There's a movie in the park night, men's breakfast coming up, as well as Vacation Bible School. Make sure your kiddos are registered for that. Just a word, if you have any questions on anything you ever see on here, make sure to ask Heidi or whoever is serving at the Welcome Center within a given week. They have all those answers for you. It'd be a good resource for that. Just a couple other things. There's a potluck happening right after service today. It's going to be awesome. If I were you, I'd plan on staying. There's going to be a lot of good food, good fellowship. If you did not bring anything, or even if you're new with us, we'd still love to have you. There'll be plenty of food. Again, it's going to be just a good time to fellowship. So join us for that right after service today. Then if you are new, last thing, there's a connection card. Looks just like this. You can find this in the pew in front of you. If you've never filled one of these out, you take just a few moments and do that. You can drop that off at the Welcome Center as you leave. We would be thrilled for you to do that. Thank you for doing that. Thanks for being here this morning. Other than that, I want to take us to Psalm 68 as we kind of prepare for worship this morning. So would you go there with me? It's be on the screen. You can grab a Bible in front of you if you need one as well. Psalm 68. I'm going to read just verse 20 for us this morning. I'll give you a moment to find that. Psalm 68. You can find it in a pew Bible on page 482 if you need to use one of those. Psalm 68, verse 20 says this: Our God is a God of salvation, and to God, the Lord, belong deliverances from death. Great news. Would you pray with me this morning? Well, God, we praise you for what we've just read in the short verse, that you are a God of salvation. That's your nature, that's who you are. And so we pray for fresh salvation in this room this morning. God, for those of us who have experienced your salvation, we're thankful today. We pray that the reality of that would sink deeper and deeper into our souls, that we would be more and more grateful and thankful. So would you lead us today as a church? Would you go before us in all things? Would you be glorified in all things? Would you make us glad in our Maker this morning? We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. At this time, I'm going to invite Nick Petrucia up. He's going to share a little bit about Chi Alpha, which is just an awesome ministry we support on the Carroll campus.
Awesome. Thanks, Clay. Hey, thanks for having us. I think I made this joke last time I was here, but the food alone is worth the trip from Helena, and we just appreciate you guys putting on a barbecue every time we come here. but anyway, hey, thanks for having us. Like you said, my name is Nick, and my wife and kids are in the back there. She's wrangling them, Haley, and we have three kids, young kids, so we're very busy. But we do college ministry. It's called Chi Alpha in Helena, Montana, and we mostly reach out to the college at Carroll College, and Chi Alpha stands for Christ's Ambassadors, and we get our name from 2 Corinthians 5:20. It says we are therefore Christ's ambassadors, and we're reconciling students to Christ, and that's what we do. Helena Chi Alpha has been in existence for a little over 20 years now, and we've been there for 10 years as leaders, and Haley was there for 4 years, and I was there for 5 years as students. where God made a huge impact in our life. We met in college, and then we met Jesus in a very real way in college, and he called us into ministry, and we've been there ever since. And Chi Alpha, it's taken on a lot of different looks over the last 20 years, but God is really on the move, and we're really honored that we get to be a part of it. And over, I'd say, maybe even just like the last few years, God has done some pretty amazing things. And I wanted to highlight a few of the things that we do as missionaries. Our call looks a little bit different than a Sunday service, as the way we do ministry is through discipleship. Discipleship is huge, and we only have 4, maybe 5 years to impart the ways of Jesus into college students. And so it has to be very intensive. And so a lot of what we do is one-on-one discipleship, where we sit down across the table from students or sit down at a coffee shop, and we just impart the ways of Jesus on them. And it's amazing to see some of the things that these college students are dealing with. But it's cool to see, because they're at a stage of their life where they're very moldable. And when the Lord gets a hold of their heart, he can do amazing things through it. And so we've seen that. We've experienced it ourselves. And it's a unique missions field. And then another thing that we really like to emphasize is retreats. So getting away, and we offer a lot of retreats throughout the year, getting away to spend time, intentional time with Jesus. And God does some amazing things through that. Calls students higher, calls them out of sin, maybe puts a call on their life. And then another thing that we do is missions trips. How many people here have been on a missions trip before? Okay, quite a few of you guys have. And missions trips are life-changing. It helps get the focus off of us and onto God, onto other people, and serving them. And we had some pretty awesome opportunities this year to do missions trips. We took 4 spring break missions trips this year, and we did 2 overseas missions trips. And the spring break trips went to Port Orchard, Washington, where we worked at a Christian horse camp. There was another one that went to Boise, Idaho, where they worked with a church plant. Another one that went to Laramie, Wyoming, and they worked with another Chi Alpha. And then another one that went to Seattle and worked with the Unity Gospel Mission. And I just wanted to highlight a quick story from the one that Haley and I went on to Port Orchard, Washington, at Miracle Ranch, where there was a student that came. He's a student leader, and he was leading a pretty successful small group. And on the trip, we always like to try to challenge our students and kick their bucket, if you know what I mean, to see what's on the inside. And one of the best ways to do that is to do a day-long fast. And on that day-long fast, there was some things that was revealed in one of these students that was a little bit ugly. And as he said, that the pride was oozing out when all of the comforts were stripped away. And it was pretty cool to see what the Lord did during that time, because he came back to his small group and he apologized for some of the spiritual pride that that he'd been leading with, and it completely changed the atmosphere of his small group. And he said that he learned how to love better during that time, and it was pretty cool to see how the horses were part of that, and then other students were able to gather around him and pray for him, and the life transformation that happens on those trips. And then let's see, we had, like I said, 2 overseas mission trips that happened this year. There was a student trip that went to Kyrgyzstan and Uzbekistan. And I don't know about you guys, but I didn't even know those countries existed until they went there. But they're kind of in Central Asia, south of Kazakhstan, which borders Russia, so kind of in that area. It's called the Silk Road, so not quite like the Middle East, but anyway. That trip came about. It was pretty cool because, I don't know if you guys probably realize, traveling can be a little bit of a challenge, especially early on in the year. And so we had the opportunity to go, and man, it was powerful. It was really powerful because not only did it minister to the 10 students that went, but it was a huge leap of faith for the parents of those students as well, as there's a lot of unknowns that go with that, and then, you know, some of the unrest that's going on in that part of the world. But it was pretty cool to see how God was ministering to the parents, to the students, and also to the workers that are in that area. And on that trip, horses are a big part of the culture there. And in Helena Chi Alpha, we have an equine program where we use horses to exemplify our relationship with God. And so just to emphasize the relationship that we can have with God, we use the horses to show that. And on that trip, there was a girl that went, and the way that they treat horses there is not a relationship. It's just like a working transaction. And it was such a great parallel for her to see that's what it's like in Islam. And Islam is like a working transaction that you have with Allah. If you do these things, then you might make it into heaven. And for her to see that that was what was there, but God offers so much more. That you can have a relationship with him, and it was illustrated through the horses, as she saw the difference of how a horse was treated there and then how a relationship is built here in the Helena equine program. And so for her to have that parallel and then bring that back was really powerful, and for other students to see that as well. And I had the opportunity to go to Amman, Jordan, and Jeddah, Saudi Arabia. And this trip was a little bit different, as it was an exploratory trip, because if you didn't know, the Middle East is constantly in flux, and things are changing all the time. Access is changing all the time, and right now there's more access in the Middle East than there ever has been. And so getting workers there to be able to share the gospel is of the utmost importance. And so we went there to see how our local Chi Alpha could partner with some of the workers in the area to bring teams and maybe even long-term missionaries there. And so that was the purpose of the trip. And we got to see what it was like firsthand ministering to Middle Easterners, specifically Muslims. And it was powerful. It was really powerful to see. There's a lot there's a lot that I could share, and I'd love to share some stories, but one thing that I just want to highlight is the amount of opportunity and access is amazing. For me to go over there, I could bring my Bible, I could openly talk about what it was like to live in America and to be a Christian. But for the local believers, there is a lot of persecution, and it is very challenging to be a Christian there. And when we got to go to some of the house church services, they met in secret, and they had soundproofing on all their walls. They didn't want people to know what they were doing, because it could be tough, and a lot of people can be persecuted and could be deported or sent to prison and things like that. And so it was very real. But as a foreigner, I had privileges and opportunities that they didn't. And so that's why they're trying to get workers to come over, and college students are some of the prime workers that they want. And so that was the purpose of the trip. And I can remember sitting in the back of a bus. The bus was thick with smoke, as everybody smoked cigarettes a lot there. And I'm talking to these college students about their faith. And they're telling me about what Islam is like. And they told me that at the end of the day, if your good outweighs your bad, then you're going to make it into heaven. And they have no assurance of salvation. They're not sure until that judgment day if they're going to make it. And I shared with them that that you can have a personal relationship with God right now. It can be life-changing. And you can know right now if you're gonna dwell with God in eternity. And that was like a foreign concept to them. And it was something where we talked about it. There was no immediate life decisions made, but it was the first time that they'd ever heard the gospel before. And that's the type of opportunity that we have, is that they're very open to talking about faith. They want to talk about faith. The hardest thing for me was just finding someone that spoke English. Arabic is a challenging language to learn. And so those are some really cool opportunities that we've had. And one other unique opportunity that we have in Helena Chi Alpha this year is that we're starting an internship. And this internship is been a long time in the works, and it's a big deal in Chi Alpha, as we're going to be able to formally train and send missionaries from Helena Chi Alpha. And it's a pretty intensive year. It's pretty much like a master's level. They're going to be reading about 3,500 pages worth of books, and there's 32 objectives that they have to meet. Things from like specifically ministry things like preaching and teaching and missions, all the way down to like how do you budget, how do you fundraise, how do you have work and free time balance and stuff like that. And it's pretty cool, because there's 30 in the nation out of the 300 campuses that Chi Alpha is on, and we're by far the smallest. There's no campus that's even close to where we're at. They're all in large state schools, and so it's a pretty cool opportunity to have students come and be a part of that internship. And we just want to thank you guys for allowing all this to happen. that it's your guys' giving that allows us to be there to see this life change happen. Not only are you guys making an impact here in Townsend, Montana, Canyon Ferry area, but you guys are making a difference in Helena Chi Alpha and across the world. As there was three students that went on that Kyrgyzstan trip, they're now contemplating full-time overseas missions. And you guys are making a difference around the world. And so thank you for that impact. And in Helena Chi Alpha, it's all about transformed lives. And students can have their lives transformed while they're in college, but if it doesn't last when they're outside of college, then it's a failure. And we really want to see that life transformation happen. And so again, we just want to thank you guys for the opportunity. Thank you guys for your giving, and thank you guys for what you're doing here. You guys are a real encouragement to us when we get to come. You guys are kind of like a home away from home. And so anyway, I'm going to go ahead and pray, and then I think the worship team is going to come up, and get to hear the message today. So Heavenly Father, we thank you so much. Jesus, we thank you for what you've done in our life. Lord, we thank you for your grace. Lord, we thank you for the story that you've written in our life. And Lord, I pray, Lord, that you can help us to see the need around us. Lord, that we can have your eyes, your ears, your heart for the people around us. And Lord, we thank you. We thank you for the opportunities that we have. And Holy Spirit, I just pray that we can be obedient to what you ask us to do. Lord, that we're not trying to do more or less, but Lord, we're just obedient to what you ask us to do. And Lord, I pray a blessing over the Trailhead Fellowship. Lord, thank you for their encouragement. Lord, thank you for their generosity. Thank you for their giving. And Lord, thank you for their encouragement. We just pray that you can speak to our hearts today. In your name we pray, Jesus. Amen.
Thank you, Nick. If you guys have questions about Chi Alpha, find Nick and Haley after. They'd love to chat. So we're going to sing now. Would you stand with us? We're going to start our worship by singing All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name.
All hail the power of Jesus' name, let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown.
Song this morning called Christ Our Hope in Life and Death. And what this song is going to do is lyrically, it's going to give us the vastness of our hope in Christ. So it's not just hope for life, it's hope in life and in death. We just read in Psalm 68 that God delivers from death. And so no matter what comes our way, whether it's today, whether it's tomorrow, whether it's just death itself, even, we have a big hope. Amen. So we're going to sing this full of hope this morning. If you know the song, sing with us. If not, as you catch on, sing with us. But we're going to rejoice in the hope we have in Christ this morning. Let's sing.
What is our hope in life and death? Christ alone, Christ alone. What is our only confidence that our souls will end on? Who holds our days within? Apart from His command, what will keep us to the end? The love of Christ with which we stand. Sing. Oh, sing hallelujah, our hope springs eternal.
Oceans in his hands, who has numbed
Good morning, church. Good morning. Are there any of you that would just like to keep singing for a little while this morning? Thank you, worship team. That was fantastic. Fantastic. If you've had a chance to listen to the new song that we sang, please take a few minutes, even in this coming week, to listen to that song. I realize when we're teaching a new song, it might be hard to really catch everything that's going on there. But if you stop and think a little bit about the words that we sang, you will be moved. Powerful, powerful scriptural truth that we were able to sing to each other this morning. And how many of us don't need that hope today? That one day sin and death will be destroyed? That we'll be feasting at his table? Does that fill you with some hope? Does that get your pulse going a little bit this morning? I pray that it does. Imagine that sin will be destroyed. No more sin in our lives. Boy, do I look forward to that day. What a day that'll be. Would you open your Bibles with me this morning to the book of Luke, chapter 15? I'm going to invite Mr. Justin Tiffany to come forward. He's going to read this text for us today. This is a relatively long passage. It's a pretty well-known text. We're going to read all of chapter 15 for you. I'm going to be focusing on verses 11 through 32, but really wanted to read the whole chapter to make sure that we have the context here. So we will turn it over to Mr. Justin. If you are looking on your pew Bibles, it's page 874. Page 874, Luke chapter 15.
Having 10 silver coins, there we go. If she loses one coin, does not light a lamp and sweep the house and seek diligently until she finds it. And when she has found it, she calls together her friends and neighbors, saying, "Rejoice with me, for I have found the coin that I had lost." Just so, I tell you, there is joy before the angels of God over one sinner who repents. And he said, "There was a man who had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, 'Father, give me the share of property that is coming to me.' And he divided his property between them. Not many days later, the younger son gathered all he had and took a journey into a far country. And there he squandered his property in reckless living. And when he had spent everything, a severe famine arose in that country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him into his fields to feed pigs. And he was longing to be fed when the pods that the pigs ate, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, "How many of my father's hired servants have more than enough bread, but I perish here with hunger? I will arise and go to my father, and I will say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your hired servants.' And he arose and came to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt compassion and ran and embraced him and kissed him. And the son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Bring quickly the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet. And bring the fattened calf and kill it, and let us eat and celebrate. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' And they began to celebrate. Now his older son was in the field, and as he came and drew near to the house, he heard music and dancing. He called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. He said to him, 'Your brother has come, and your father has killed the fattened calf, because he has received him back safe and sound.' But he was angry and refused to go. His father came out and entreated him, but he answered his father, 'Look, these many years I have served you, and I have never disobeyed your command, yet you never gave me a young goat that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours came, who has devoured your property with prostitutes, you killed the fattened calf for him.' And he said to him, 'Son, you are always with me, and all that is mine is yours. It was fitting to celebrate. Be glad, for this your brother was dead and is alive. He was lost and is found.'"
Thanks, Justin. Would you bow your heads with me as we continue to worship the Lord together this morning? Dear Father, this morning we come to you. And dear Father, we worship you for all that you have done for us. Dear Father, for your grace that you continue to pour out on us like the waves of the sea. Pounding on the shore, you have given us grace upon grace. Dear Father, this morning we come with heavy hearts. Dear Father, even as we rejoice with those who rejoice and we mourn, we grieve with those who grieve. Dear Father, this past week we've been thinking and praying, especially for Andy Van Dyken. Dear Father, as the family has said numerous times, he needs a miracle. Dear Father, we praise you that you are the God who does miracles. Dear Father, you are the great physician. Dear Father, we pray that you would bring healing to Andy's body. Dear Father, that you would rid this cancer from him. Dear Father, this morning we want to pray for Kendall. We want to pray for Jackson and Otis. Dear Father, we want to pray for Rick and Helene. We pray for Jason and Heidi and for Bridger and Colton. Dear Father, would you continue to strengthen them? Would you undergird them with a strong sense of your love? With a strong sense of your presence upholding them during these difficult days. Dear Father, we pray that you would bring Andy home on Wednesday or this week. Dear Father, that he can be reunited again with his family. Dear Father, we pray for others in our congregation that are in need of healing. And dear Lord, those that have lost loved ones recently, we pray for Marlene Zapala. We pray for Joe Brummer, Sr. Dear Father, we pray for your continued comfort for them, for their families. Dear Lord, we praise you for the good report from Wilma Wortman earlier this week, the good procedure that took place with her heart valve. Dear Father, we give you praise for those answered prayers. Dear Father, this week we pray for the campers that are continuing to go to camp throughout this summer. But Father, we pray for Camp Utmost, for the leaders, for the campers, for the staff. We pray for everyone that's going up there that you would keep them in safety, that you would do a powerful work there this week. Dear Lord, we pray for the churches of this area. We pray for the churches of Broadwater County. We pray for Pastor Eric Crush at the Elkhorn Community Church this morning, that you would be filling him with your spirit, that you would be speaking your word through him, that you would be edifying the body there, that they would be sanctified, that they would be built up in Christ. Dear Father, we pray for Nick and Haley. We thank you so much, Lord, for the report that Nick gave. We praise you for the good work that you're doing through their ministry. Dear Father, we pray that you would continue to encourage them, even as they're here with us today. So, Lord, we love you. We pray that as we look at this text this morning, this familiar text, dear Father, that we would be struck again with your heart for the lost. And, dear Father, may we be motivated to share your word with those that are lost. We love you. We give you praise for this time. Would you speak now clearly through me? In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we pray these things. And all God's people said, amen. This morning, I wanted to start my sermon with this question. How many of you have seen the movie Vacation? Chevy Chase, hopefully you saw the edited version. The edited version, seriously, the edited version was my family's favorite movie for many, many years. And part of the reason that it was our family's favorite movie was because we had lived that ourselves. How many of you have ever been on a vacation like what you saw in that movie, where almost anything that could go wrong did go wrong? That happened to my family and I in 1984. I was 11 years old. I had just turned 11 years old even during this trip. And we went to California, of course. That's where you go when you grow up in Northwest Iowa. And it was really the once in a lifetime kind of a trip where my parents pulled out all the stops. We got a 1973 Holiday Rambler camper. It was like a 16-footer, wasn't very big. We borrowed it from some family friends, and we headed west. And like I said, everything that could have gone wrong did, even in the first day. Our radiator went bad. We jammed the lock on the camper door. You name it, it went wrong. But we finally made it out to California. While we were in California, we went to a place called Marineland. Not sure if you've heard of Marineland. I don't think it exists anymore. It was similar to SeaWorld. You've heard of SeaWorld? This was basically SeaWorld before SeaWorld was popular or something. It might have been the smaller version of SeaWorld. I really don't know. All I know is we were at Marineland, and we were looking at all of the dolphins and other marine life. And somehow, I got separated from my family. Now, this was not a huge, huge place, but it was a big enough place that when I realized that I was disconnected from my family and didn't know where they went, I panicked. Like I said, I was 11 years old and didn't know where my family was. So what did I do, being an 11-year-old? Well, I thought, well, if I start walking around, surely I'll find them. I must have spent at least a half an hour. It seemed like hours, but it must have been at least a half an hour walking around that park, looking for my family, not finding them. But I'll tell you the joy that was mine when all of a sudden I saw my dad coming towards me. and realized I was found. Like, I had all these visions of being abducted and stranger danger and all these kinds of things going through my mind, because that's what they teach you in school, right? So when I saw my dad, there was great relief and great joy. The lost had been found. The summary of my message today is this: worship the one who came to seek and save the lost. Worship the one who came to seek and save the lost. As we've been working through these parables of Jesus, I have said to you numerous times that context is key. That's part of the reason that we read those first number of verses in this chapter for you. I wanted to point your attention to Luke chapter 15, verses 1 and 2. Would you look there with me? Luke chapter 15, verse 1. This is really, really important. We need to grasp this before we go further into this parable. It says, "Now the tax collectors and sinners were all drawing near to hear him." Now, we're going to see there are two groups of people here, the insiders and the outsiders. The insiders and the outsiders. We're going to start with the outsiders. The outsiders were the rejects from the world's perspective. The outsiders were those who were not in good standing religiously as far as the Jews were concerned. The outsiders were the tax collectors and the sinners. That's what we see here in this text. What's fascinating to me is that it was these outsiders that were drawing near to Jesus to hear what he had to say. Isn't that fascinating? But now in contrast, look with me at verse 2. It says, "And the Pharisees and the scribes grumbled, saying, 'This man receives sinners and eats with them.'" These were the insiders, the Pharisees and the scribes. These were those who had influence from the perspective of the world, those in good standing religiously as far as the Jews were concerned. They were the religious leaders. We know that. The Pharisees and scribes. Isn't it fascinating what they're doing here in this text? What are they doing? They're grumbling against Jesus. So you've got the insiders that are drawing near to hear him. You've got the outsiders that are drawing near to hear him. You've got the insiders that are grumbling against him. That's really, really important for us to see. The Pharisees and scribes, those that were grumbling against Jesus, were saying, "This man receives sinners and eats with them." That's what eating with someone in that culture meant. You're accepting them. That's what they were seeing Jesus do. He's accepting these outsiders, these tax collectors and sinners. Scholar, author Chuck Tedrick says these words that really helped to lay the foundation for our study. He said, "These two groups were listening to Jesus. One group was listening with the ears of faith and receiving the words of salvation. The other group wasn't hearing but being judged for their deafness and hardness of heart." That's what's happening here in this text. So that brings us to the parables. We've got three parables. The first one is a searching shepherd. I'm not going to read this text for the sake of time, but that's what we saw as Mr. Justin read this text. The shepherd goes after the one lost sheep. Why does he do that? It's 1 out of 100. Think about that. It's only 1 out of 100. But to the shepherd, that was unacceptable. It was unacceptable to lose even one. So he goes out and searches for the sheep, and when he finds it, the shepherd rejoices. Not only does he rejoice, he shares that joy with his neighbors. We're going to see that again as we work our way through chapter 15. But then we see this in verse 7. "Just so," Jesus said, I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance. The joy in heaven over one sinner is great. That brings us to the second parable. The second parable is that of the searching woman. The searching woman. Now we see the stakes rise here. With the sheep, it was 1 out of 100. That was 99% were found, right? It was only 1% that was lost. Here the stakes rise. The woman lost 1 of her 10 coins. That's 10%. I know. I'm really smart. Actually, it's not true. But that's true, right? 1 out of 10 is 10%. She had lost 1 of her silver coins. If you think about it this way, this was her savings. This was her nest egg. So to lose that coin, that silver coin, was a really big deal. The woman searches diligently until she finds it. She finds it finally after her diligent search, and then she goes and shares it with her neighbors. What's lost has been found. Rejoice with me, I have found my silver coin. Look with me then at verse 10. Verse 10 says this, just so, this is Jesus speaking again, I tell you there is joy before the angels of God over one sinner who repents. That brings us to this third parable, and that's of the searching father. The searching father. If you will, the stakes raise even higher because this father had 2 sons and one of them was lost. Right? That's 50%. 1 out of 2. And some of us might even say, actually, both sons were lost. That's 100% were lost. But we're going to get more into that as we look at this parable today. As I said earlier, I know this is a familiar parable. We're all pretty familiar with it. We know what happens to the prodigal son. If you look at verses 11 through 16, the son says to his father that he wants his share of the inheritance. That was like wishing the father was dead. This was an insult to the father. And the son says, give me my share of the inheritance. And the father says, okay. And the son goes out and he squanders it in reckless living. Till he gets to the point where he's in need himself, to the point where he doesn't have anything and no one would give him anything. So he's feeding on the pig feed. That brings us to verse 17. Would you look with me at verse 17? It says, but when he came to himself, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have more than enough bread? But I perish here with hunger. I will arise and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your hired servants. I want you to see this. The younger son comes to his senses. He develops a plan to return to his father and repents. This is important for us to see. He repents. He turns from his sin and returns to the Father. He believes his Father might allow him to be a hired servant. So look with me at verse 20. It says, and he arose and came to his father, but while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt compassion, and ran and embraced him and kissed him. The father, according to some scholars, was seeking the lost son. There's a sense that this was something that he would do on a daily basis, go and look for his son. That helps us to understand the father's heart for his son. He went to look for him in case he was coming back. It says he saw him while he was still a long ways off. He felt compassion. He ran to him. He embraced him and he kissed him. Do you see the Father's heart for his Son here? Look with me at verse 21. It says, and the Son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. There's such a thing as worldly repentance. And then there's such a thing as godly repentance. And that's what we're seeing here. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. I don't deserve that anymore. What I did against you was sinful. It was wrong. This is true repentance. Look with me at verse 22. But the father said to his servants, bring quickly the best robe and put it on him and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet and bring the fattened calf and kill it and let us eat and celebrate. For this my son was dead and is alive again and was lost and is found. And they began to celebrate. The father shares his joy with the neighbors. We've already seen that, haven't we, in the two previous parables. With the shepherd and the woman who found the sheep and the coin. The father spares no expense. He throws this great party for his son. I want us to see this today. The father could have shamed the son, couldn't he? But is that what he did? He could have said, son, I told you so. But he didn't say that, did he? He did not shame the son, but demonstrated a heart full of love and joy. But then this story takes a turn. Would you look with me at verse 25? It shifts to the older son, the older brother in this story. It says, now his older son was in the field, and as he came and drew near to the house, he heard music and dancing. And he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said to him, your brother has come and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has received him back safe and sound. So the son is wondering about what in the world is going on. Look with me at verse 28. It says, but he was angry and refused to go in. His father came out and entreated him. The older son, after he hears what was happening for his younger brother who had returned, is angry. He's throwing a pity party. I know that none of you have ever done that before, but that's what this older brother is doing. It's like he's laying on the ground, kicking his feet and screaming, no, I'm not going in. I'm upset about this whole situation. But the second part of verse 28 says, his father came out and entreated him. In other words, the father came out and said, come on in to the party. Look with me at verse 29. But he answered his father, look, these many years I have served you and I never disobeyed your command, yet you never gave me a young goat that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours came, who has devoured your property with prostitutes, you killed the fattened calf for him. What is going on? You can imagine him pounding a pulpit, right? Saying, what is going on? Probably not exactly what happened, but the older son explains why he's upset. These many years I have served you, I never disobeyed your command. This is really, really key that we see this. All these years I have served you, I have never disobeyed your command. Remember the two groups of people Jesus is talking to? The outsiders, the outcasts, the insiders, the religious leaders. Think about that. The older son is demonstrating, even by these words, he just said that he is self-righteous. He thinks he is right. He thinks he has a right to be angry. Sometimes we are that way too. I got a right to be upset. He thinks the father is unjust, that the father's been holding out on him, that the father is unloving, that the father is unfair. Look with me at verse 31. The father responds. He says to him, to the son, son, you are always with me, and all that is mine is yours. In other words, All you had to do was ask. It's all yours. That's the Father's heart. It's all yours anyway. Verse 32, it was fitting to celebrate and be glad, for this your brother was dead and is alive. He was lost and is found. So we come to the end of this parable, and we realize once again that even here, the father doesn't respond in anger to the younger son for insulting and embarrassing him, for not coming into the party, for making the father leave the party to go out and entreat his son. That was insulting, that was embarrassing to the father. And yet the father doesn't shame him or respond in anger. He says, you are always with me. And all that I have is yours. But then he says, it was fitting to celebrate and be glad. Your brother who was dead, it was like he was dead. He's alive again. He was lost, and now he's found. We had to celebrate. We come to the meaning now of this parable. What are we to receive? Even today, what are we to see here in this parable? There really are three themes that I want to touch on this morning. The first one is this idea of going from being lost to being found. From being lost to being found. We see this in all three parables, right? A sheep that was lost, there was a coin that was lost, there was a son that was lost. Lostness in these parables is an image of sin and separation. Do you see that? I realize, and I don't mean to insult anyone's intelligence this morning. This is probably, you probably already know this, but it's good for us to be reminded of this. That's what lostness is in this parable, an image of sin and separation. But then we think about foundness. What's foundness? What's foundness about? Foundness is about an image of salvation and reunion. Salvation and reunion. And all of us are saying together, of course that's what it's about. Of course, we see that. We realize, don't we, that sin destroys relationships. Sin destroys relationships with God, with others, with ourself. That's just the nature of sin. And that's what we are to see here in this parable. But salvation, on the other hand, salvation restores these relationships with God, with others, with ourselves. And I don't think that I need to say this, but I'm going to, that in these parables, Jesus is the shepherd. Jesus is the woman. Jesus is the father. Luke 19, verse 10 says these powerful words. This is Jesus speaking. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. You ever wonder, why did Jesus come? Well, there's more that we could say, but isn't it summed up in that verse? The Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. Jesus seeks until he finds, and then he calls others to rejoice with him. I want to just ask you a question right now. How many of you have been lost but were then found? Spiritually. I'm getting very little response here, and I really was expecting more. How many of us have been lost but then were found? And then you think about the rejoicing that has happened in heaven over you, over one sinner who repents. That's what this story is telling us, these three parables. Jesus seeks until he finds, and then he calls others to rejoice with him. What a great picture. What a great picture. So we see this moving from being lost to being found. And then in the second theme that I want us to see this morning is the father who seeks both sons, both types of people. As I mentioned earlier, there are two groups of people listening to Jesus as he speaks these parables. And some of you might be able to relate with these two groups of people. They were the outsiders, the tax collectors and sinners. They were the insiders, the Pharisees and the scribes. I don't know what it was like for you in high school. I never quite was an insider. I wasn't unpopular, but I wasn't popular. I was just kind of somewhere in the middle. And some of you might be able to relate with that. Do you feel like you're an outsider religiously, or maybe you feel like you're an insider? Well, let's remember what the definitions are. And what I just said about high school really doesn't apply at all. So you can just throw that all out. The two sons represent the two groups. The younger son represents the outsiders. Again, I don't mean to insult any of our intelligence, but it's good for us to be reminded of this. The outsiders were considered bad by conventional standards. They were the notorious sinners who don't want relationship with the Father, at least at first. They were estranged from the Father because of their bad deeds. They were, but they were desiring to draw near to hear Jesus because they were starting to understand their need. You see that? It was the outsiders that wanted to come and hear him because they were realizing this man is speaking words we need to hear. We're hearing grace from him. They're starting to understand their need, and furthermore, they're experiencing his mercy and compassion because he was eating with them. The older son represents the insiders, those who are considered good by conventional standards. They were self-righteous, like the older brother. They were self-righteous. They think they are good with the Father because of their outward moral behavior. Brothers and sisters, this was me for 38 years of my life. For 38 years, I didn't know it until later, until the Lord really opened the blinders to help me see the beauty of the gospel of Christ, the glory of the gospel of Christ, when I was 40 years old. 39 years old? I was the older son who thought that my relationship with God was based on my good behavior. I couldn't have been more wrong. Could not have been more wrong. These insiders, like the older brother, were estranged from the Father because they believe they are deserving of rewards. They are estranged from fellowship with the Father because of their good works, because they think that they are good and don't understand their need for the Savior. They were grumbling against Jesus because he's extending mercy and compassion and forgiveness to others. Others they don't think deserve those things. Do you see the problem here? I said, do you see the problem here? With that type of mentality. Thinking we're good. I don't need his forgiveness. I don't need his grace. I don't need his mercy. I'm a good guy. I don't drink, smoke, chew, or go with the girls who do, right? That was before. Beth doesn't do those things either, but. I never mean to throw her under the bus, and sometimes I do that I don't intend to. I hope that that wasn't taken that way. But that's the truth. I grew up believing those things, believing that if I just did these basic things, that I would be good with God. And many of you already know this. I was so self-righteous. And I couldn't even see it. Couldn't even see it. I thought it was my good behavior that was getting me in with God. Brothers and sisters, it's not how it works. It's not how it works. Here's the amazing truth Jesus is communicating through this parable. Like the father in the parable of the prodigal son, he is seeking both groups of people. Praise his name! He sought me, the older brother. And some of you maybe can relate with the older brother. He has sought you if you are in Christ. And if you're the younger brother who knows what it was like to live a wild life of blatant rebellion, he sought you as well. He seeks both groups. Amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I didn't think I was a wretch, but I was. I was. Jesus wants to extend grace, mercy, compassion, and forgiveness to both groups of people, to those who have sinned blatantly and understand their desperate need for forgiveness, and to those who have lived pretty moral lives but are far from God because their hope is in their self-righteousness. Do you see that the Pharisees are the harder ones to reach here? It's the religious people who are the harder ones to reach because they don't think they need the gospel. And that is the truth. The question at the end of this parable, the parable of the prodigal son, is this: what will the self-righteous Pharisees and scribes do? What will they do? Will they continue to grumble against Jesus because of his mercy towards tax collectors and sinners? Or will they rejoice at the mercy God makes available through Jesus, his son? He was right in front of their eyes, and they couldn't see it. Oh, may the Lord give us eyes to see our need for Christ. Oh, may he give us eyes to see. So we've seen moving from lostness to foundness, and we've seen the Father who seeks both sons, and that leads us to the third one. That's the selfless and self-giving son. Just briefly, there's another son in this story, and I know you know where I'm going with this, don't you? You know who he is. The one telling the story is Jesus, the Son of God, of course. He is the seeking, saving one. He came to save selfish sinners like the younger brother and the self-righteous sinners like the older brother. All who come to him in repentance and faith will be saved. Did you hear that? All who will come to him in repentance and faith will be saved. We have that straight from the Word. When they do, there will be rejoicing in heaven. Brothers and sisters, worship the one who came to seek and to save the lost. Would you bow your heads in prayer with me? Dear Father, we praise you for this glorious truth. Dear Father, obviously there's so much more we could say about each of these parables, especially the prodigal son story. But dear Father, we praise you for these major themes that we see. Dear Father, we praise you for the King's heart that is for sinners. Gracious, merciful, compassionate. For those that realize their need, their deep need for the Savior. Dear Father, I pray for each of us here today that we have realize that need or will realize that need very, very soon. Father, may today be the day of salvation, even for some that are here. That today would be the day that they would repent of their sin, that they would turn from their sin, just like the younger brother, and return to you in faith, believing that what Christ did on the cross was sufficient to pay the price for their sins, to reconcile them to you, Father. Dear Father, we praise you for your word. We praise you for these truths. And dear Father, again, we pray that we would be passionate about sharing this truth with everyone that we can. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we pray.
Amen. In light of that, we're going to stand and sing. I stand amazed this morning. Will you stand with
back.
and he bore the burden to Calvary and suffered and died alone. And how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be.
There's a pastor in the room who has a birthday today, and he might be bald, and he might be right here. Make sure to give him a happy birthday.
In light of that, you're all welcome to stay for the potluck afterwards. I think we've got plenty of food. So you are all welcome to stick around in fellowship. There is no place that I'd rather be today than with you all. And that's the truth. I'm grateful to be able to say that in all sincerity. Thank you. Would you receive the benediction now? May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God the Father and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And all God's people said, amen. Thank you so much for being here. May God bless you as you go.